Hey everyone, my name's Drew, and we are here, and this is going to be the draft analysis for Season 7 of the UBL. Now, we've been here for every dang season of this thing, and it's been a whole ton of fun. We've been here from the very, very beginning. We've made playoffs every season but one, and we've had a lot of fun. We've made a ton of friends and a ton of playoff runs, but this is honestly one of the strongest teams I think I've ever put together, and I'm really, really excited about it. But honestly, that just gets compounded by the fact that this is by far the most stacked season ever, right? So I believe this is a full five-star league on the website. From top to bottom, this league is stacked with so many champion coaches and so many fantastic coaches that this is going to be a really, really tough season. This is going to be probably one of our toughest seasons yet. But again, it's one of my favorite teams that I've ever put together. But with that, I'm going to get right into it. Now, before anything else, we did have a full slate of 16 coaches, and I was ninth out of them. So my chances of getting something that I really, really wanted felt really slim. And As I generally do, I wanted to kind of challenge myself to get something that I've never drafted before. And it's getting more and more difficult as time goes on. Whereas this time around, it got to me at number 9, and I genuinely struggled to find something that I really wanted to use and I've never used before. And it generally hasn't been that this difficult for me in the past, but I think just as time goes on, it's going to get more difficult, especially kind of with a limited decks. Hopefully whenever the decks does get expanded a little bit, it'll be a little bit easier. But for right now, it was really tough. And sorry, I had a pause right there to sneeze. I've been really, really sick coming into 2022, and it's been tough, but we're trying to soldier on. But with that, we're going into the number one pick with Excadrill. Now, Excadrill, I've never used it before. I'm hoping to have a lot of fun with it, but it felt like I could get a lot of things out of the way early on, right? I could get a good steal, good ground, not get kind of sniped out of those early on, and kind of in this current meta, it's really tough to find steals without drawbacks and fairies without drawbacks, right? Because I feel like they're like a top couple, and if you don't get those top couple, then it just falls off a cliff really steeply. And this was one area where I really wanted to get those rolls handled early, but Exodus just does a whole ton for me. It has a really strong attack stat. It can potentially sweep. I think I can really build out some sweeping sets with Rapid Spin being what it is now. It changes its dynamic a whole ton. And even just utility sets like AV sets, I've seen a ton of good different subsets, but I think it can do a lot here. It can set up hazards, it can remove hazards, it can just be a monster, it can hit like a truck, right? So I really have a lot of confidence for what this thing can do. It's just going to be a matter of getting used to it. I think this is a mod that's definitely going to take me personally a little bit of time to kind of get used to using, but I think once I kind of get dialed in with it, I think it'll be a whole ton of fun to use. But look, at the end of the day, you don't need me to tell you what an Excadrill does. I'm sure you've seen it used 1,000 times before, and it just does what it does really well, right? Next up, pick number 2, we have Cinderace, and Cinderace was honestly one of the Pokemon that I've had the most fun using ever, and it's also been really interesting because like I've been saying with kind of steel and fairy types where they kind of fall off, it's been really tough finding good fire types that I kind of enjoy using and that I can kind of consistently bring every week. But I drafted Cinderace once before, and it was one of the most fun Pokemon that I've ever used. It's not necessarily the best, but I think if any of you have been considering it, I think it's one of the most fun you'll ever have using it. And it really kind of clicked in for me, I think, like halfway towards that season. I think it was the first UBL season since Sword and Shield that I drafted it. But I think it really dialed in for me when I realized, oh, I could just find a way to bring this thing banded and find it and build the set around just like assuming bringing it banded, where it really kind of unlocked it for me. And I just had a ton of fun with it. And I think I came up with some really fun non-banded ways of using it in the postseason of that season. But there was a run where it was just entirely fun to just bring banded every dang week and just have fun with it, right? But with that, we can kind of start to see a little bit of common weaknesses, a little bit of kind of frailties starting to develop here with the first two picks. So with the third pick, I really kind of feel like I needed to start getting some bulkiness, some pivoting options. And I went with a mon that I've never drafted before, but I think will be a lot of fun, Slowking. Right, so I've drafted Slowbro before, and it was a ton of fun. Slowbro can kind of almost dang near like win games on its own, and it's carried some certain wins just on its own. Slowking should function reasonably similar, but obviously I have a lot of different kind of considerations with it. I think it'll be a ton of fun. It still does a lot of what I needed to do. It's going to be a super bulky water type. It is unfortunate to not get a super offensive water type this early on, but first of all, there's still plenty of time left to go. There's still plenty of things that can happen, but I think overall, for what I need my team to look like, Slowking just does a lot of what I needed to do. And at the price it was, it was significantly cheaper than Slowbro. I don't remember exactly how it pans out, but I think it was like at least like 2 to 3 plus points cheaper, and it really kind of fit everything that I needed to do really well. Oh, and I shouldn't have mentioned now that we did have 110 points for 11 mons required, which I think ended up being a pretty good place to set it. A lot of us were worried about not having enough points to go around, but a lot of teams had to make difficult decisions. And I think ultimately, the way that my team and a bunch of other teams kind of panned out, I think ultimately it worked out really, really well overall. I think maybe 5 extra points would have been fine, but I think it would have taken away a lot of uniqueness from this draft, which I really kind of ended up appreciating by the end. And I think, and I would encourage you to look at a whole bunch of other players' drafts and see kind of how they turn out. And I think you guys would agree that that there's a lot of uniqueness to this draft that I really appreciate here. But okay, now we have pick 4, and pick 4 is a little bit controversial because I really didn't know what I wanted, but I know that I wanted to kind of build out more of a defensive core, defensive backbone, and kind of get a lot of the utility that I feel like I needed. And many people argue that this was too early, but again, it just felt right in the moment. It felt like what I wanted and what I needed for my team moving forward. And it's something that I was kind of in such an awkward position drafting wise that there was a lot of anxiety happening from like what's gonna last me basically a whole round, because it's like half a round going up and then half a round getting back to me. So every pick came with a lot of anxiety, and I ended up going with Drudagon for this pick. Now, Drudagon does a whole ton for me. I've drafted it once before, and I had a ton of fun with that team. I think Drudagon offers me a lot, right? I think just being able to sub-glare sets. That one season with Drudagon was the first time that I really attempted a sub-glare set. I had some friends kind of make fun of me for that, but there's a lot of value in it, and I think for a team like the one that I'm trying to kind of build out, I think that's kind of exactly the kind of skill sets that I'm trying to expand with and trying to incorporate with this team. But I'm sure many people will talk about how early this has gone and how it fits in the overall team. I think it's really unique for what it does, and Drudagon, in every way that I think it needs to make sense for me here. And with that, with the fifth pick, this is kind of the stage of the draft here. I kind of went back and forth a lot with Aquarius because I was really unsure of the kind of the direction that I wanted to take things. And I really kind of struggled with this because I really wanted Serena here. And honestly, I think what ended up happening was I really wanted Serena, and the pick before Drudagon, Serena was taken. So I think I took Drudagon instead as almost a placeholder, but not really. And it really kind of put me on an weird path because I didn't know what I wanted, and I really wanted a grass type that didn't invite U-turn a whole ton because I wanted to kind of be the one kind of dictating the tempo of these matches. And so that kind of took me off of a mon like Zarude, where I was really hard considering Zarude early on, and I was thinking about it more and more, options for what grass types to get, about options of what electro types to get, and I had this kind of cluster of mons in my head for the next few rounds that I talked over with Aquarius. And we kind of came to the agreement that I can kind of afford to wait on a grass type, but this is a mon that I couldn't afford to wait for yet, and it's going to be Vigavolt, right? So Vigavolt gives me a ton here. Vigavolt just happens to give me webs. I don't think webs will be the biggest for what my team is going to end up looking like, but I think Vigavolt is an absolute monster, right? I played with Vigavolt in an Ubers league once, and Vigavolt was, I think, my KO leader just because it just got so many opportunities to agility up and just terrorize things. I think defensive Vigavolt, it makes a ton of sense, and it just puts out so much damage with its attack stat that it's really difficult not to find uses for Vigavolt, and it's so strong, it's so versatile. I think it just does a ton for my team overall, and I'm really, really excited to use Vigavolt here. And one really fortunate side effect of having Vigavolt is I think that the combination of kind of Drudagon, Vigavolt, and a couple of other picks later on that are being planned out is that it kind of makes me a lot less susceptible to U-turn. Therefore, it actually makes a ton of sense for what my team looks like to go ahead and pick up that Zarude. So we go ahead and pick up that Zarude. And I love Zarude. I used Zarude in a draft with Victini, and it and Victini were trading blows for KO leader. It Zerud just does a whole ton for me. It fits the way that I like to play a whole lot. A lot of fast pivoting and a lot of strong pivoting. And it kind of fits the way that my play is kind of shifting now, where I am kind of making a more concerted effort to play more aggressively. And I think Zerud kind of fits in that mold really well. And I think it kind of offers me a ton here. I think it kind of can help me down certain psychics. It has really good speed for what I need. And overall, it's really strong. It gives me a lot of what this team needs to look like in terms of offensive pressure and pivoting potential. And now, with that kind of cluster of picks taken care of, and I think kind of a lot of what the makeup of the team is going to look like kind of taken care of and glued together, now we're kind of looking at more of like the utility section of this draft, and we're going to start things off with Gigalith. Now, Gigalith does a ton for me here. Obviously, it sets up sand. It does give me something that has to be respected in team building. I don't think I'm the type of player that's going to rely on sand a whole ton here. But I do think, again, just giving teams more things to think about in team prep, I think is going to be worth its weight in gold, right? I also think it's a really reliable rocker. At this point in the draft, I kind of need something to kind of eat up flying hits. Aquarius definitely pointed that out to me. It has a really strong specially defensive presence. It has a really strong physically defensive presence. It can body press. It can just do a whole ton for me here. It can pressure a lot of things that I needed to be pressured. And it just kind of can maneuver itself in a lot of different ways that I think are going to be really valuable for me. I think you guys can kind of see a lot of the kind of holes that I have on my team typing wise, and it is something that I talked through with Aquarius a little bit, because again, I really did want a couple of really strong mons in certain types, but like I was saying before, there are a lot of types where if you don't get the first few, it just really drops off. And long story short, I ended up getting Aromatisse here. Now, Aromatisse, a lot of people would argue, is a fantastic fairy. I think it is a really, really solid fairy. I think, if nothing else, it helps me a ton in prep. It helps me a ton in switching into things, in pivoting to a certain extent. I don't know how comfortable I will feel kind of going hard in terms of kind of Trick Room call mindsets, but I do know that Aromatisse is definitely capable of taking over games on its own. I have drafted this thing in the past and call minded up a million and won games on it, or dang near won games on it. I think it is a really strong pickup for me here in prep, in pivoting. I do kind of worry about not having a really strong offensive fairy presence, but like I said, it's just kind of not something that a lot of teams can kind of make room for in this kind of semi-limited decks here. I love Aromatisse. I think it fits my team really well, but I will 100% understand if somebody watching it kind of thinks it's a controversial pick, or it's a subpar pick, or whatever the case may be. I don't know. A lot's going to depend on how I use it, but I do think it gives my team a different dimension, and a lot of what I'm kind of looking for is giving my team as many kind of dimensions and as many kind of top to bottom routes for viable different kind of branches that I can kind of go. And I think Aromatisse gives me a lot of that. And it also gives me a really, really strong wish passer, which for a mon like Igalith, this is kind of exactly what they kind of needed here. But with that, going on to the next pick. Now, I think we have a lot of kind of what we need, and these kind of last few picks are going to kind of define the kind of niche situational teams, but I think I really have a strong last few. With that, we're going to get right into Weezing. Now, Weezing is just a monster, right? Weezing is fantastic. It can toxic spikes. It can eat up toxic spikes. If it's neutralizing gas, it can be really interesting with neutralizing gas, right? It can Will-O-Wisp. I should go back to it, but neutralizing gas adds an entirely different dimension to my team that's not the most thought about, but it can do a decent amount here, and I think it can put teams in an interesting position if I can figure out certain creative ways of using it. But overall, I mean, Weezing just is a really fantastic mon on its own, right? I don't think there's much to really say about Weezing other than it's a really fantastic mon on its own, and I think it fits my team really well. It gives me a dimension that my team really needs. And I think it's going to have a ton of value for my team moving forward. Now, with that, another interesting pick is a mod that I've never used before, I don't think. But I think I'm going to have a lot of fun using it. It's going to be very interesting using it. It's going to be Stoutland. Now, there are a couple different things about Stoutland. Obviously, there's the sand mode. I don't think I'm going to be the type of guy to use it a whole ton in sand. But people have to think about it. It's there. It's an option. The thing that sold me most about Stoutland, right? It was a normal type. And I knew that I wanted a normal type, but I was kind of conflicted on a bunch of them. I thought about Bouffalant, which was taken. I thought about Double, because I love Double. I think Double is a monster. There are a number of different normal types that I considered. But Stoutland, I think, is one of the strongest AV potential users. But then once I found out that it gets access to both both Yawn and Thunder Wave, it was on the spot for me, right? It has access to Intimidate. I think it gets Scrappy as well, if I'm not mistaken. Yawn, Thunder Wave, utility sets, potential AV sets. I think it makes a ton of sense for my team. And I think it's just, it's just an absolute monster of utility in what I kind of want to use it for. And now there's the final pick, right? And one interesting thing about the way that my team turned out is that I ended up budgeting myself better than I expected to. So I had more points than I expected to by the end of this draft. And I was looking at what I could do with all these points that I had in the end. And I really didn't know what I wanted with all of these points that I had. I really kind of struggled with it, but I ended up going with Tornadus Incarnate. Now this pick, honestly, I don't know how it'll be received with my overall team and the way that it looks. But I honestly think it's pretty fantastic for what my team looks like. It gives me some speed that I really needed. It gives me a strong kind of special offensive presence. It gives me a ton of pivoting options. It gives me a ton of utility options. And overall, I think it can kind of do a ton for me here. And honestly, I've been kind of scoping out some other teams, some other matchups that I'm going to have. I think honestly, this and another Mon together could potentially be top KO leaders on their own. If I had been asked when this draft started, if I had been considering Tornadus Incarnate, I would have said no. And if I was kind of forced to budget around like a Tornadus Incarnate, I probably would not have tried to do it. But I think with the way that my overall draft ended up happening, it was a bit of a happy accident that I had this many points at the end. And I think overall, it really kind of holds the team together in a way that I did not expect at all. But I think I'm really happy with now that I get to see the final team and that I can kind of see the way that it all kind of came together and was built out this way. I'm really, really happy with this pick overall. And it might not seem like a whole ton now, but I absolutely believe that it's going to be vying with some mods for at least my personal KO leader. And honestly, for the whole dang league, I think. But with that, that's a draft, right? This is going to be season 7 of the UBL. This is going to be the last one before kind of the World Cup kind of goes in a full swing. So a whole lot of people are kind of thinking about that in terms of how they want to perform this season. And this is a really strong league with a whole ton of good players. With that, thank you guys so much for watching. We'll be back really, really soon with more weeks of the UBL as well as other things to come in the near future. But once again, with that, thank you guys so much for watching. I'll be once again out.